Well, praise the Lord. It's good to be here again. I'd like to welcome each and every one that's calling in through the Lord's Roundtable and those that are listening by the airwaves that are going from one end of this great planet that God has created for us to the other end of it. And this evening is like all evenings that we come to sit around the Lord's Roundtable. You know, we depend on the Lord, and He draws who He wants here. He draws the our brothers that come and our sisters that come to speak. You know, you all know me. I do not like the word guest. That sounds too secular to me to address a family member as a guest. You're never a guest if you're a family member. Amen. How many of your family members got to knock on your front door before they come into your home? Only a guest has to do that. So there's no knocking to come to this door. You just come, pull back a chair, sit down, kick your shoes off, get something to drink, non-alcoholic, and we're going to sit back and we're going to enjoy this evening. Tonight, our brother, he's been here many a times before, and you'll all remember him. It's Brother Ron Hankin. And Brother Ron, we're excited to see what the Lord's laid on your heart tonight. We're excited to see what we need to hear, whether it be correction, conviction, or whatever it may be. Amen. We don't, you know how it is here, Ron. We don't deal with that sugarcoating. We don't want candy store preaching.
Right.
All you get is a toothache and a sick stomach afterwards. We want to hear the word of God. We want to hear it as true as the Lord lays it on your heart. So, brother, it is all yours, and we're excited to have you with us.
Hey, thanks again, Steve. Thank you for inviting me. And a couple months ago, you asked me, you had an opening in November, and you asked me to do it. And I've been so excited waiting for my turn to be able to come and share what the Lord has laid on my heart. I've had the privilege to do the Truckers Prayer Line a few times for Wes Frazier. And shout out to Wes and Joyce, who are they're pastoring a church down in Chattanooga now. They took on a new pastorship, so I'm gonna pray and lift them up and Joyce up in prayer for the new ministry that they've been called to do there. And again, just thanks, Steve, and for all those that are listening, what a privilege and an honor it is to come. So if we can, if we go to the Lord in prayer, if you're driving, obviously don't bow your head. But if you're not and you're just sitting around somewhere and the comfort of your home or sitting in your vehicle somewhere, whatever the case may be, let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask His hand to be upon the word. Heavenly Father, we honor You, we praise You, we glorify You. We ask, Father, that You anoint this message, that You use me, Father, in any way that You see fit. We pray that You open eyes, spiritual eyes and hearts to hear the word tonight, Father. May it be that quick and powerful two-edged sword. May it go in and divide. May it correct. May it do whatever it is that You want done this evening, Father. May it instruct and teach, strengthen, help, heal, whatever the case may be, Lord. We pray for that anointing, for it's the anointing that destroys the yoke. It's the anointing that breaks the chains of bondage. And Father, we just ask that You move. Holy Spirit, have Your way. And for every person that's out there, I speak a blessing upon you, your families, and pray that you open your heart to hear the word of God tonight, and may it minister to you in a mighty, mighty way. In Jesus' name, we ask, we pray, we believe, we receive. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Well, thanks again for allowing me to be here. Just kind of studying this the past 2-3 weeks as this time was coming closer for me, and I knew that it would be an opportunity for me to speak, and just went to the Lord in prayer and said, Father, what is it that You want to for me to say? What is it that You want to do in the people's lives that will be listening and upon the prayer or the round table, the Lord's round table tonight? And, you know, just been really moved lately by things that are going on in the world, all of the strife, all of the arguing and bickering and all the stuff that's been going on. It will consume your time if you watch any amount of TV. It's just, it's, it just seems like everything is just torn upside down. I don't remember a time, I'd have to go all the way back into the 60s, I believe, when I was, you know, in school as a school kid in the 60s, and all the strife and the stuff that was going on in this country. It just seemed like every week there was some kind of a monumental thing that was trying to just seem like it was going to tear this country apart. And that was a very, very tough time. I was a product of the 60s. I was a young product of the 60s. But that was a very turbulent time in America's early, you know, future. And it just seems like lately it's just kind of like the same kind of stuff going on where it's just crazy about it. And as I prayed about it, I said, Lord, this is just terrible. And then he just kind of laid it on my heart that it's not only in this world that's going on, but it's families. It's families that are being torn apart. It's all of these big spiritual battles, it seems like. And that's what he laid on my heart, that what we see out here in the natural, that's more or less the symptom. It's not the cause or the effect. It's the symptom that we're seeing. And the cause and effect really is a spiritual battle that's going on out there. It's a spiritual battle for countries. It's a spiritual battle for our families, our children. They can't go to school today. Look at the pressures that our children are under as they go to schools, or if they try to live for the Lord, or if they're out there in the world. Look at the stuff that's out there that's just sucking them into it. It's relationships and families being torn apart. I don't care where you look. It's turmoil and chaos. But what the Lord, again, is laid on my heart is the actual battle is in the heavenlies, you know, and it's there that Satan is making his big stand. It's in the spiritual realm that's causing the things that we see in the natural realm. And so I just want to I wish I had a whole lot of time. But for the amount of time that we have tonight, I just want to touch a little bit upon spiritual warfare, you know, and about the stuff that could be going on in our country, in our families, in our churches, in our schools, in the universities of America, and all across the world. You know, I just want to start here with like 2 Timothy, 3rd chapter. And 2 Timothy, 3rd chapter starts out by saying, this know also that in the last days perilous times will come, for men will be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. So, I mean, he was, the book of Timothy here that Paul wrote to Timothy, he's saying in these last days, these are the things that's going to be happening in the world. And, I mean, it doesn't take a rocket scientist right now to look around and say, we are certainly in the beginnings of these last days. I mean, these things that Paul was saying here are coming to life before our eyes every day. Every day we're seeing some form of this. You know, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. I read something the other day that talked about how church attendance in America in the last 20 years has fallen off almost 25-30% down from what it was just 20-30 years ago. Now, I mean, I'm sure every generation has said, these are the last days. Look at how bad things are. But goodness gracious, look at what we live in today. and what faces our children. I can't even imagine what my grandchildren are going to have to deal with and see, the atrocities that are going to happen. And we're in a really, really tough spot. And so I said, Lord, that's not going to be news to anybody when I say that. So he laid on my heart and he says, no, that's not going to be news. But what we want to talk about is, how do we combat this? He didn't just put us upon this earth at this time. Look, we're all here at this time for a purpose. We're not here by circumstance. Every one of us that hears the sound of my voice tonight, we're alive for a time such as this. It's our time to be Christ followers. It's our time to take up the cross and follow him. It's our time to preach the gospel in this wicked generation that we're living in. And he didn't just put us out there to do this without any hope. I mean, you can get caught up and listen to this stuff, and you can be overwhelmed in the flesh. But thank goodness that we're not going to fight this battle in the flesh. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 says, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ, and being ready to punish all disobedience with when your obedience is fulfilled. So he's telling us there that, look, though it feels like the war is in our flesh, it's not. It's a spiritual war. But he says, our weaponry, look at the words that Paul is using here to the book of Corinthians. He's talking about warfare and weaponry, strongholds. He's talking about the things that he was battling about 2,000 years ago, and how much more prevalent that is today, that we need to be built up in our most holy faith, that we need to figure out how to fight this war that we're in, because it's not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of this world, spiritual wickedness in high places. Hallelujah. So this is a tough battle. So what do we got to do? Well, obviously, we have to use the resources that God has given us. What has he given us? He's given us his word. The word of God is mighty, 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 mighty to the pulling down of these strongholds, right? And so just like if you were to join the army today, tomorrow, you join the army. The army doesn't, Navy, Marine Corps, whatever, they don't just take you and put you on the front lines the next day. No, you got to go to boot camp. You got to get in shape. You got to learn to fight. You got to learn to defend. You got to learn to take orders. You got to learn to find out where your power is and where it comes from, and how to fight as a team. So you go through this boot camp, don't you? So you go through a boot camp to prepare you for the battles that are coming ahead. So we need to do the same thing. We need to go to the word of God and say, Father, in your word, you tell us that all of these things are going to happen. All of these things are going to come against us. We fight a foe. He's a defeated foe, the Bible tells us, but he's a foe, and he's out to defeat the children of God. He's out to defeat the purpose of God in your life. Every person has a plan for their life that God has laid out, and Satan's biggest thing that he's trying to do is destroy the plan of God in our lives, in our children's lives, in our grandchildren's lives. He's trying to stop the power of God from moving in our life. So we've got to find out, how do we fight this foe? The Word of God tells us how that we're going to do that. The Word of God is going to take us through boot camp, spiritual boot camp. We're going to build up our most holy faith in the things of God. We're going to do it through reading God's Word. We're going to do it through spending time in prayer about the things that are attacking us or the spiritual wars that we're against or that are coming against us right now, whether it be in our hometowns, our state, our country, whatever the case may be, our own children, our grandchildren, our brothers and sisters, whatever the case may be, there's things that are going on in our lives that we need to have wisdom and guidance about. And the only way we're going to get that is by spending time with the Spirit of God, spending time alone in God's Word, praying in the Spirit, asking the Holy Spirit to reveal truths to us. Then we got to take the next step. And the next step is starting in the book of Ephesians, 6th chapter. Finally, my brother, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. So it's not our own strength. We got to be strong in the Lord because the power is in his might. Put on the whole armor of God that we may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of this age, spiritual hosts of the wickedness in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, stand. Now, you got to think about Paul when he wrote this book of Ephesians. He was in a Roman jail, probably sitting there in a Roman jail, looking at the guard that was guarding him in jail. And here is the epitome of strength at that time, the Roman army. So he's looking at this soldier and the way that he's in the weaponry and the way that he's defended by the armor that's on him. And I believe the Spirit of God said, use that and talk about how we need to be clothed in that same armor in the spiritual realm to fight the spiritual battles that we're up against. So therefore, he goes on to say in verse 14, stand therefore having girded about your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, take the shield of faith with which you'll be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So there we go. There is the armor that we need to put on, the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith. Hallelujah. Meditate on this, on these scriptures. Meditate on God's Word. Let the Holy Spirit reveal those hidden truths in your heart of what he's trying to tell you here. If we put this weaponry on, some of this armor is for defense, and some of it, the sword, is to attack with. That's not a defensive weapon. That's an offensive weapon. So remember when Jesus was baptized in the Spirit, he got baptized in the River Jordan by John. The Bible says immediately the Spirit of God came upon him as a dove, and the Spirit took him out in the wilderness to be tempted. How did he defeat Satan in the wilderness? He did it by saying, it is written. And not just that he said it was written, but he said it's written and then quoted the scripture. The Word of God in the mouth, in the heart, first of all, down in the heart of a believer, meditated on, put in there by spending time, meditating on the Word of God, feeding on the Word of God, feeding on the Word of God, and then when spoken in faith, is a mighty offensive weapon. Satan couldn't stand that. He can't stand the truth. The Bible said he's a liar and the father of lies. liars. But our God is truth. Truth is one of those weapons. Loin, gird about with truth. So when we speak God's word, when we meditate on it, we put it in our heart and in our spirit man, and we speak it for the problems that we're going through. Whether, again, whether it's a problem in our home, on our work site, in our church, in our community, whatever it is, when we begin to pray about a situation, we find God's promises that cover that situation. We feed on that. We meditate on it. We build up. We're in boot camp. We're allowing the Spirit of God to strengthen our spiritual muscle. Then we speak that word. We pray over that situation. And we release our faith of God's word. It has power, people. Brothers and sisters, I'm telling you, it has power. We've got to learn to use the power that's invested in God's word. Then we have, on top of all of this great, great spiritual armor, what else do we have? We have the name of Jesus, the name that's above every name. You talk about an offensive weapon. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Proverbs 18:10. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and are safe. Glory to God. Remember the story about Peter and John when they went up into the temple? Acts chapter 3. They went into the temple in the hour of prayer, and there was a certain man there from his mother's womb was carried. He's laid out of the gate for the temple called Beautiful. And he was there every day asking for alms from people, asking people to help him out, begging, basically begging. And Peter looked at this man and he said, "Look at us." And the guy looked at him, Peter, like Peter was going to give him some money or something. But Peter said, "Silver and gold I do not have, but what I have I will give to you." So he had something to give, didn't he? He said, "In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. So he leaped up, stood, walked, entered into the temple with them, walking, leaping, and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God, and they knew that it was he who was there that begged alms at the Beautiful Gate. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened. Now, as this lame man who was healed held on to Peter and John, all the people ran together to them in the porch, which is called Solomon's, greatly amazed. So when Peter saw it, he responded to the people, "Men of Israel, why do you marvel at this? Or why do you look intently at us as though by our own power or godliness that we made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered up and denied in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. But you denied the Holy One and just and asked for a murder to be granted unto you. And you killed the Prince of Life, whom God raised up from the dead, as we are witnesses of that." And this is the part I want to get to. "And his name, through faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know. Yes, the faith which comes through him has given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all." Peter said, it's the name and faith in the name. Peter said, "I don't have anything to give you, but what I had to give, this is what I got, the name of Jesus." And that man believed, and when he believed, the power of that name of Jesus, pow, he was healed. He was healed. The name of Jesus, hallelujah, the most powerful name. The Bible says every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. Well, I don't care what it is. I don't care if it's cancer. I don't care if it's a money situation. I don't care whatever name it's running under. It has a name. And the Bible says if it has a name, it's got to bow its knee. Because the name of Jesus is the greatest name ever spoken by mortal lips. Some men curse it. There was a time in my life where that name didn't mean much to me. I'm sure I used it as a curse word. I blaspheme. But that name is the most precious name in the world to me tonight. It's the name that caused my life to be touched and changed. I called upon that name. The Bible says that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That word saved means to be made whole, to be healed, to be delivered, to be set free, to have salvation. There's no other than, the Bible says there's no other name under heaven whereby men can be saved. Only the name of Jesus. That's why the Christian faith is the only faith that you can be born again. You're not going to be born again under Muhammad or any other name. And I'm not trying to knock religions today, tonight. What I'm trying to say is the Bible says there's only one name under heaven whereby men can be saved. And it's the mighty name of Jesus. Glory to God. Praise his holy name. The blessed name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's the greatest, greatest name. Greatest name. Hallelujah. Jesus said in the book of Revelation, Book of Revelation, chapter 2. I'm sorry, chapter 1. He said, I am he that was dead, but I'm alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and hell. Nobody's done that. Nobody has gone and snatched the keys of death and hell except our Lord and Savior. He said, therefore, you go. Hallelujah. You go. He tells us in the book of Mark, 16th chapter, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. And these signs shall follow those that believe. Here it is, in my name, the name of Jesus, Yeshua. These signs shall follow those that believe. In my name, they'll cast out demons. They'll speak with new tongues. They'll take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it will by no means hurt them. They'll lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Glory to God. The name of Jesus. You know, the book of Revelation also says that they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. The Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. I am the redeemed of the Lord tonight. And I plead the blood of Jesus Christ over every person that hears my voice, over every one of their family members. The blood of Jesus Christ, that same precious blood. The blood, if you think about it, when they took that blood and put it over the doorpost in Egypt the night before the Passover, before they were finally let go out of 400 or 500 years worth of bondage. The death angel passed over, saw the blood, passed over. So what a weapon that is. The name of Jesus and his precious blood that was shed. Begin to do a study in God's word about that precious blood and what that means in covenant. When we take communion and we think about the precious blood, the redempting power of the blood of the Lamb. I'm telling you, folks, whatever we'll fight, we're going to fight. And we've got some nasty days ahead of us. I don't know what's going to happen in the next 10, 15, 20 years. I don't know if the Lord will return by that time or not. I do know that all signs point that we're closer than we've ever been. But if we can just see in this country the persecution that's going to come upon this church, upon the church, as this country turns farther and farther away from God. pastors will be forced, I think they'll be forced to marry people that are same sex and things like that. I think this government, it just seems like it's turning that direction, that we're going to have to fight for our spiritual lives. So what do we need to do about that? We need to begin to pray for our country. I don't care who's in office. I didn't vote for Barack Obama, but we had to pray for him when he was in office, because the Bible tells us to pray for all people that are in authority over us, from every party. I don't care what party they represent. Just because my own beliefs, political beliefs, didn't line up with his, he still was the leader of the country at the time. We got to pray for those people that are in authority over us. All this is going on now with the president. We need to be praying over it, because I'm telling you, the war is in the spiritual realm. That's what's going on. And it's all about to tear America apart. This great land that was conceived upon beliefs of Almighty God in 200 years, a little over 200 years, it looks like it's going to fall on some very, very hard times. Because the majority of this country, I would say the majority of it today, doesn't believe that anymore. But thank God there's still a remnant in this country of believers, people that will stand firm in the things of God, will pray for this country, pray for its leaders, pray for peace, pray for prosperity for this country. It's the greatest country that's ever been out there. It helps more people, touches more lives than any country in this world because of our freedoms. And those freedoms came at a great cost. So spiritual warfare, we've got to all fight it. We're not going to get out of this thing unscathed. We're going to have to learn to fight the good fight of faith. So how do we do it? Get into God's word and study. Spend time there. Pray and ask. I don't care what situation you're up against, whether it's a situation for healing or finances, whatever it is. Find the promises of God that talk about that situation. Meditate on those promises. Keep them before your eyes. Meditate on them. Get them down in your heart. Pray over them. Then use the weaponry that you have provided you. Study on that weaponry. Find out how to apply it. You've got the mighty name of Jesus and his precious blood. Use them. Use them. Bind the enemy. The Bible says that whatever I bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever I loose on earth is loosed in heaven. Take authority over the enemy. The Bible says resist them, he'll flee from us. Resist the devil, he'll flee. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We've got a thief that only comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Jesus said, I've come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. Glory to God. I don't care what Satan's trying to do in this world. We've got a God that's a mighty God, and he's already the victor. Jesus said, I have been there. I've got the keys. All authority's been given unto me. Therefore, you go. He's commanded us to go forth and do the things that he wants us to do. Hallelujah. Praise the mighty name of Jesus. Praise his holy name. I'd like to end by just telling you a story about something that happened in my life. I'd like to end it this way. We talk about spiritual warfare. The Lord laid this on my heart. I wasn't even going to say this until about, 10, 15 minutes before 6 o'clock, before we went on. I was praying and asking God, and he brought it to my remembrance. And I thought, well, there you go. He wants me to bring this up. Back in 19, went to a Baptist church when I was a young person. My parents did not go to church. My parents were not church-going people. At 12 years old, 1968, I was going to a little Baptist church. It was a church bus that would go down the street and pick the kids up. And I asked my parents, I want to go. I want to go to church. Don't know why, just always had this thing that I wanted to go. And they said, that's fine. We'll get you up on Sunday mornings. If you want to go to church, you can take the church bus. The only thing is don't come home preaching that to us. So I went. I love Sunday school. I gave my heart to the Lord in Sunday school. March 9th, 1969, I gave my heart to the Lord. Still remember the date. Still remember the Sunday school. Still remember the Sunday school teacher's name. And as a young kid, I didn't know what to do from there. I obviously didn't. I stayed in church for a while and didn't seem like things, was turning into a young teenager, getting into driving and all the stuff that was going on. And I walked away. I got away from the things of God. But what I want to say is this. I got in March 9th, 1969, as I gave my heart to the Lord that summer. My parents are from the South. My parents took us to Tennessee for vacation. And I remember sitting in a little Baptist church that summer and sat back there with my cousins and we're probably not listening to the sermon much. We're doing the elbowing thing and all that. But anyhow, at the end of, make a long story short, at the end of this church service, they started playing the song, Just As I Am. I'm sure you all know that song. And something come over me to quit goofing around and to be serious. And just a young boy, had only been saved less than 6 months. I clearly heard the Lord speak to my heart and said, look up there, there's your dad, the front of this church. And he was sitting up there in the front row. His head wasn't bowed. He wasn't singing. And he said, you need to pray for your dad because he's lost. He's dying and going to hell. And I thought as a young boy, oh, Lord, that, please don't do something, you know. Cause him to be saved. Have him walk up front and give his heart to the Lord. Prayed that little simple prayer. Nothing happened. My dad, in the church service ended, and we went away, went on our way, and I didn't get much thought about that. I got away from the things of God, got out in the world, as most young people will, if there's, you know, nobody at home talking about the things of the Lord, and I got away from it, and I got really bad. I could have lost my life from drug overdosing and a lot of other things, but that's neither here nor there. But something miraculous happened in 1979. My parents got saved. They gave their heart to the Lord. I was living out in the world as deep in sin as one could ever imagine. And I don't say that with a lot of pride. It's very ashamed of the way that I live my life. But my parents got saved, got in the Holy Ghost Church, and began to pray for their kids, for the family. And by early 1983, 84, I had a catastrophic thing happen in my life. I overdosed and almost passed away. And my parents came to the hospital, and they were praying for me. And I knew that what they had was the right thing. I didn't want to hear it. I was living my own life by that time and was not interested in what their life was. I was glad for them, but I didn't want to hear it. But they prayed for me that night, and I felt God's power touch my heart and life, and he gave me another chance. And I prayed, and I said, Lord, if you let me live, I'll give you my life back. Well, that lasted about 30 days, and I was back out there doing it again. But about 6 months of that, and finally, the Lord convicted me of enough, and two or three more times of overdosing, I knew that my life had to change or I wasn't going to be around here long. So I did. I made that commitment. I got back in church. And my dad, who I didn't want to be around, became my best friend. That he and I spent so much time together, and he is my spiritual father, and he was hungry for the word things of God, and it gave me that same hunger. And we studied together, and we bought tapes and books, and we had oodles and oodles of teaching aids, and I began to grow spiritually. Make this long story shorter, is I got an opportunity. I was out of work, and I was hired into General Motors right out of high school, but I was out of General Motors for 2 years because I had gotten laid off. 1984, I got an opportunity to go to Grand Rapids, Michigan. And when I went up there by myself. I was so broke, I had to borrow money from my parents to get my first month rent. I went up there with a lawn chair that I used in my living room, a small black and white TV that sat on the floor, and a mattress that was in the bedroom. My wife at the time was pregnant with her second child. She stayed in the Detroit area because her doctors were there. And I was in Grand Rapids living by myself, trying to start this new life of spiritual life. And it was a struggle because the same people that I was partying with in Detroit, half of them went to Grand Rapids with me. So it was just a struggle every night to leave work and go home and be by myself while they were all out doing their thing. So anyhow, here's the end of this thing. So I work second shift. So every hour and a half or so before work, I spent before the Lord in prayer. And I remember I would go into this little bedroom of this little one-bedroom apartment that I was in, and I would get on my knees by that mattress, and I would pray, spend time with the Lord, 30, 40 minutes, sometimes all the way up to an hour. And I was praying this afternoon, and I don't know what happened, but something walked in that room. I mean, it sent cold chills, and every hair on my body stood up. Something came in that room. I didn't look. Head was bowed, my eyes were closed, I was praying, but this being came in this room, and it did something to my brain. I'm telling you, like it took its claws and put in my brain. I couldn't think. I couldn't tell you what my name was. I would have had to pull my driver's license out of my wallet to tell you what my name was. It was just like lockdown city, and I kept trying to think of something to do. And this came out of my spirit, the name of Jesus. Just that, just the name of Jesus. That's all I could kept hearing in my spirit was Jesus. So I began to say that, Jesus, 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 over and over. And bang, that thing left. Just as quickly as it came in that room, it hightailed. I mean, I had just praising God and worshiping and the glory of God filled that room that I was in, that little one-bedroom apartment. And just like the story that Paul talked about where he was taken away and he said, whether I was in the body or out of the body, I don't know. But he said, I ended up in the third heavens. Well, I ended up somewhere. I never went to heaven. But the Lord took me to that place as a young boy. Now, I hadn't thought about this. You got to think about this, folks. This is 20 years, maybe, later. Almost 20 years later. Took me back to that little church that summer of 1969 to the place that where I could see the church. I could hear the people singing, just as I am, without one plea, that his blood was shed for me. I could see myself in the pew. I could see my my cousins sitting next to me. Sorry. I could see everything going on. I could smell it. It was so real. It was like I was there again. I could see the thing unfolding like a picture show. The invitation coming. Us bowing our heads. The prayer. And the simple prayer that I prayed and looking at my dad and seeing him not move and nothing happening. And the Lord spoke to me and he said, you forgot that prayer, but he said, I honored it. Glory to God. He said, I honored that prayer. A prayer of a young boy. I'm telling you all of this to say this. There's a spiritual battle going on for the lives of our kids, our parents if they're not saved, our nieces, nephews, cousins, uncles, aunts, I don't care who they are, our neighbors. And we might think that a simple prayer doesn't mean much. And I'm telling you, if it's prayed by faith, God will honor the prayers of his people. We have a spiritual battle to fight. We're here for a time such as this. We want to be victorious. Paul said to run the race that's set before us, laying aside the weights and the sins that so easily beset us, but run the race that's set before us. We got to run it in faith, folks. We got to figure out who we are in Christ. And once we find out who we are in Christ, then we need to be act on who we are. We are heirs of God and joint heirs together with Jesus Christ. It's time that we begin to fight the good fight of faith, to stand for those that can't stand for themselves, to stand for authority, to stand for this country, to stand up for it, and to take authority over these things. All the weapons that we need, everything that we need is in God's word. Everything that we need, he's already provided for and more. Now it's up to us to get in boot camp, learn it, study it, meditate on it, be strengthened, build up our faith, and go out and do the things he's asked us to do. Lay hands on the sick. Believe when we pray that they're going to recover. Cast out devils if we have to. Stand in the spot for people that can't stand for themselves. For we are Christ's ambassadors. We are the church of 2000 and almost 20 now. This is it. We're it. We have to be. Everybody else that we read about in the Bible, they've had their time. They fought their battles. They did the things that they needed to do. Now it's our turn. We were born as a time such as this, and it's our turn to be who God wants us to be. Heavenly Father, whatever it is you want us to be, whatever it is you want us to do, we surrender our lives totally to you, looking unto you, the author and the finisher of our faith. Help us to learn, to grow, to strengthen, be strengthened, to grow off the milk and then get into the deep things of God, the words, the meat of the word, and help us to grow spiritually, Father, to fight the battles that we need to fight. There's people's families that are trying to be torn apart. Satan, I bind you over every person that can hear my voice. I take authority over you and bind you over their lives. I plead the blood of Jesus Christ over each and every one of them, that they be free and their families be free. If there's people out there that need healing, be healed in Jesus' name. Be healed in Jesus' name. Father, whatever you want us to do, we just want to be willing servants of yours to do what you've called us to do. Rise up big within us, Holy Spirit. Help us to be who you want us to be and do the things that we're supposed to do. Father, we ask these things in Jesus' name. I speak a blessing over all those that can hear my voice tonight. Be blessed. Be made whole. If you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, today's the day. Call upon the Lord. The Bible said that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Call upon that mighty name tonight. Call upon the name of Jesus and ask him to come into your heart, forgive you of your sins, and be made whole, and be joined to the family of the living God. Your name will be written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. You'll be given the gift of eternal life. You'll change residence from this earth to a residence in heaven. That's where we're going right now. My home's in heaven. I'm just soldiering through this place. My life's already hid with Christ and God in heaven. Hallelujah. Praise the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we worship and adore you. We glorify and magnify your holy name. Hallelujah. Steve, you still there, buddy?
Oh, yes, indeed. Didn't go anywhere. Been right glued right to this. Excellent word.
Glory to God. Praise his holy name.
Amen. Amen. I'm going to try to fire this break up here real quick. If not, I'll be back even quicker. Well, we're going to have to work on that. Always something there for us. But, you know, and listening to your word, you know, when you was talking about 25% to 30% how church attendance has dropped, you know, I was thinking about that and wondering, you know, well, now that we're going, you know, that we're continuing to go forward, is it going to continue to drop, or will we come to the point as we see, you know, the word of God says that good will become evil will become good. And as we see that unfolding right here in front of our very eyes, will that 25% to 30% turn around? Will it start to diminish and the people start to come back into the church as the things that are going on are going to oppress them? You know, we've seen that with the Hebrews in Egypt, you know. They cried to God, you know, and they once we're suppressed, when there's a tragedy, we've seen that at 9/11. You know, people start turning back to God. Is that what we're going to see happening in, you know, the oncoming days? Or as this nation, as we know it, has it been turned over to a reprobate mind in such a degree that, you know, how we see, you know, homosexuality, we see transgenders, you know, not only with that, but even with the occults that are rising up and how things are being revealed to us because of, a lot of it because of social media. We have just at the click of a finger, you know, we can be anywhere and get any kind of information. So, you know, that when you said that, that really got my mind thinking, you know, which direction is this going to go?
Yeah. Well, no, you're exactly right. I mean, look at the Great Depression, but look at the revivals that broke out of that. When people became desperate, when people are desperate, they do turn to God. It's a shame that we've all done it. When things are good, we forget them. We got this, God. We're okay. We're on our way. We forget them. But you're right. When the children of Israel would get hammered, or they would get beat up, or overthrown by a different, you know, tribe, then they would call out to God. God would send them somebody else, another deliverer. It was just on and off all the time.
Amen.
So I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to pray that what you were saying, that it's revival time. This could be the church's greatest hour. It looks like it's our worst time, but it could be our greatest hour.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I think it's going to take a lot, though, you know, to get their attention. There's so many that are sitting in pews, and they're just so comfortable sitting where they're at. And, you know, one thing, it's easy to take attendance for the pastor because he can just look out because they sit in the same pew, the same end of it, whether it be the left end, right end, or in the middle. You know, they see an empty spot. They know exactly who it is. And, you know, I'm not saying that with a critical heart, but I was talking to a brother today about that. You know, we get comfortable, and we don't like changes, and we need to be shaken out of that place. If anybody has any comments, you know me, I'll keep going. You need to jump on in, and don't worry about being rude. You can just cut me right off. Come on, Mona. I say that because I always give her a hard time.
Well, I think it was a wonderful word, definitely on time. You know, and I have to agree with you as far as the breakaway from the church. Now, social media has actually became a fad to where people don't go into the churches like they used to Sunday night, you know, Wednesday night. You see, they may have a Sunday morning church service, but no longer hold Sunday night or Wednesday night because they don't have the people there to support the pastors, you know, and things. So, and now what they do, what I've noticed as a church leader, is when they go in there and people will be on social media, they say, well, we don't want to go into church. We don't want to take the time to get dressed and go out, you know, to church when we can just watch it on Facebook now. It's good that they get it. It's good that they get it. It's good that, you know, you can see these people being reached through social media, because it has reached, you know, just what Steve does, you know, 34 countries in different languages, you know, when you bring it to social media. So, I mean, I love that fact that we're reaching people in a place that we never even dreamed of. But what I'm just saying, as far, it's sad because the Bible does say that we should assemble ourselves with the saints. And so, you know, what happened to Michael Combs used to sing a song, "What Happened to the Church Choir?" You know, what happened to the preachers? What happened to, you know, the teachers and things? You know, it's sad. It's really sad, because we used to enjoy, couldn't wait till Sunday morning to get up and be shaken by the Holy Ghost, get in the presence of God, because that's where you're going to find it, is at the true altar. I'm not saying you can't get it at home, because the Holy Ghost has slapped me several times, you know, at home. I'm just saying that, you know, we need, as a world, you know, we need to get back to our roots and be able to get back together and assembly with the saints and enjoy having fellowship with Christ again.
You know, Moni, you've been out on the road a long time as well. And I think I know you've seen the trend changing as social media came in. It used to be back in the day, at the end of the evening, those chapels that were in the truck stops, it'd be full. And even the big round countertops in the diners, you know, in the restaurants, they were full, because everybody wanted somebody to talk to. They wanted to have that socializing amongst each other and have fellowship amongst each other. But now that we are, you know, we do have so much technology in our hands, so much social media, the truck stop chapels are empty. There's so many of them that are closing down. Even the big tables in the restaurants, you know, I remember many a time sitting at a big round table, and there'd be people sitting there with you didn't know. You know, it was having a good time. But that's all changed, because we do all of our socializing through the media all day long, and then when it comes to evening, all we want to do is stay in our trucks and eat and go to bed.
Yeah. Well, a lot of it's just it's overload. It's we're bombarded with so much of that stuff. I mean, I don't do a lot of social media. I'm not on Facebook. I don't do a lot of that. I'm not on Twitter. I've seen what it's done to my children and stuff. They're sucked into this thing. They spend so much time on this, and it's like, God, it's like a big sucking. It just sucks away all your time. Now, I'm sure I'm guilty of other things, but I just never got into the social media thing. And I don't want to get it started. They're always on to me. Dad, you got to get with the times and get on Facebook. I don't want to burn my time doing that. I have a hard enough time doing what I need to be doing now. You know, I think I told you, Steve, at the beginning of the year, I had a little health scare, and I just decided that I was going to make some changes in my life, and I was going to make some spiritual changes in my life. And I just started saying, you know, this year I'm not going to listen to music going to work. I got about a 40-minute ride in the work every day, and I put YouTube on, and I put preachers on, and I listen to that every morning going to work, trying to feed on God's word. Trying to grow spiritually, you know, And it's just to take a little piece of my day and say, no, I'm not going to do what I think that I want to do, listen to music, whatever, zone out, not think about anything. But I want to hear God's word in the morning, and that's what I'm trying to do. And it's made a difference in my life this year. I can honestly say it has made a difference in my life.
Amen. Now think about this, Ron. Think about those that come to church. And, you know, I'm not trying to pick on people. I'm really not. You know, everybody's relationship with the Lord is different. You know, and some are content with their relationship with the Lord. I don't know if it's because they don't understand how much more it can be. But, you know, like yourself, you say you spend that time writing the work, listening to the Word of God. You know, I know Mona, as well as myself and so many other drivers out here, we're in church all day. Either we're having fellowship with one another, or we're doing different, going to different services that we know that are out here, or you know, or just in that we, with the jobs that we have, we're allowed to do that. We're not punching a time clock. We're not having people watch over us. We do what we want, and we utilize that time by doing that. But that's because we desire to have a stronger relationship with the Lord. And my heart really breaks, and I try to figure out how to break through this, where the contentment of, you know, 168 hours a week and spending two of them with the Lord. And I get frustrated by that, but that has nothing to do with me. You know, your relationship with the Lord, your walk with Him, what you do to seek Him, that's none of my business, you know, for me to sit back and go, well, you know, I think you should be doing a whole lot more. I had a guy tell me that. Oh, yeah, Steve, the Lord spoke to me and said, you and I need to be doing more for the Lord. And I'm just looking at my, shaking my head going, yeah, right, okay. You know, God's going to go tell you that. But you see what I'm saying. You know, the relationship you have with the Lord is what you seek. He says, if you seek me, you'll find me. Amen. If you're content with where you're at, then you're content with where you're at. But myself, he says, great and mighty things I'll show you, and I want to see those great and mighty things. I don't want to hear about them. I don't want to be told about them. I want to see them. And so for that reason, we do seek them. You know, one of my favorite scriptures, Matthew 6:33. You know, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given unto you. You know, we ask for our family members to be saved. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. You know, we ask for a better job. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. That's the answer for all of our situations. Seek God. Seek his kingdom. Seek his righteousness. And all these things will be given unto you. And, you know, I get excited about that. I see the Lord opening doors all the time. And it just blows my mind, you know, that I don't know. I'm not going to point at the ones that are content with sitting, because that's what they do.
Exactly. I think you're right on, though. But I think the thing is, though, most people don't realize they're the ones that are giving up on the things. I mean, they're the ones that are, how do I say this? They're losing out, because just like you said, Jesus said, if you draw near to me, I'll draw near to you. So we have to make the first step. We've got to have a heart that's wanting more of God. He's never said, what's the one scripture that says, if you ask, you know, you're asking the Father, if we are earthly fathers know how to give good gifts to our children, how much more will the Father give to those, the Holy Spirit, to those that ask?
Amen.
So he's constantly wants to bless us, but we have our part to do in this thing. And I don't think he wants anybody being a mediocre Christian. There's scriptures in there that scare the daylights out of me. That if you're lukewarm, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth and things like that. I don't know. I'm not the judge or jury on that. I just know that I got to constantly. I know how Ron is, and Ron can get very lazy if I let him. So I have to constantly push him to be strengthened. I know in my life, from the way that I've lived my life, that I've got certain things that I will constantly, I have to battle. Just going to be the way it is, man. It's the bad decisions and choices that I've made in my life.
Right.
I've got things I'm going to have to battle. They're just always there, and the flesh wants to go do stupid things. So if I'm gonna be victorious in my life, I've got to spend that extra time in God's Word. I've got to be reading. I cannot go long periods of time, you know, without that. I'm going to be weak. And if I'm weak spiritually, I'm going to get beat up.
Amen.
But worse than that, I'm probably going to get my head kicked in because I've got an enemy out there who's going to try to destroy me. Simple as that. He's going to try to destroy me. He's tried for almost 60-some years now, and he's not giving up, man. You'd think that after a while he'd give up. He never gives up. But I know where my limitations are. I know when I'm getting weak, I know it. The Lord speaks, and things change. Hopefully it doesn't take something drastic in your life to where you become desperate. Because like you and I were talking about, it seems like most people want to run to the Lord when they're desperate. But he would rather us be built up and ready for the intruder. What's the one scripture that says, if the man of the house would have known what hour the guy was going to break in,
amen,
he'd have been prepared. He'd have been ready.
The thief, the robber wouldn't have broke in. Amen. You know, when you
exactly
said that, when you said that about scriptures that, you know, scare you, it reminded me of a quote from Mark Twain. He said, most people are afraid of the scriptures that they don't know. He's afraid of the ones that he does mm-hmm. know.
Yeah.
Words of wisdom.
Yeah. No, I mean, I don't know, man. I just know what I need to do. I need to dig in and dig in deeper and dig in deeper.
Right.
I mean, I look at my Christian walk and I think I should be so much farther in certain areas of my life than I am. And I'm sure everybody can do that.
Oh, we all say that.
I'll be honest with you, man. I'll be honest with you. I'm my own worst critic. I mean, I'm very hard on myself when it comes to things. But in a way, I'm kind of glad that I am, because it keeps me in a direction that I think I need to go.
Amen. Keeps you in check and out of trouble. Amen. Well, brother, we are so happy.
I can sure get in it, though, man.
Oh, yeah. I know what you're saying. I know what you're saying. But we're so happy to have you here with us this evening. As always, when you come, you definitely leave us thinking. You leave us with something that we can chew on, meditate on, and something that
good
we can grab a hold of and, you know, raise us up a little bit. Get us walking in. Get it walking in, keeping on that path, you know, without, you know, stepping off of it, as so many of us have the opportunity of doing. We all have that opportunity, and it's a choice that we make on our own. But again, we appreciate you being here.
Thanks again, Steve.
And won't take.
Thanks for inviting me, man. Thanks for allowing me to do what God has asked me to do.
Nah, man, I'm the doorman.
I
didn't allow it. I'm the doorman. Don't put more on me than what I get. I don't want that, man. That's a stumbling block. I'm just a doorman. Hi, Ron. Come on in. That's my line.
I'm saying thank you for doing what you do, which allows me then to do what God has asked me to do.
Amen. Amen. We all work together to glorify the kingdom of God.
There you go.
But you know how it is here on the Lord's Round Table. We always pray before we close out. So, Father God, I just thank you, Lord. Lord, I thank you for all those that you have drawn to listen. And Lord God, I pray that for those that have listened and they don't understand what we're talking about, because your word says that your word is foolishness to those that don't know you. And Lord, I want to speak to them right now. For those of you who have stumbled across this this service here this evening, and you have heard the words that are being spoken, and you're sitting there saying, well, that's never happened with me, or, you know, I don't know what they're talking about. I would like to reach out to you right now. And I'd like to ask you, if something was to happen in your life, if something happened so tragic that your life here on this earth was over with, do you know whether you would go to heaven or not? And if you're the one that would say, well, I'm not sure, does anybody really know? Yes, we do know. Because salvation is a no-so salvation. It's a gift of God. It's not by what we can do, but it's by what Jesus Christ did, and he died for you. Yes. He didn't die just for Ron. He didn't die for, you know, the other guests that have joined with us here tonight, or possibly even your neighbor. He died for you as well. He's not a respecter of man. And it's just so simple to become a part of God's family. And he's waiting for you. He sent his son to die for you. All you need to do is realize that you are a sinner. And I can bring you to that realization real quick. If you say, well, I'm a good person, well, let me ask you, do you ever lie? Have you ever stolen anything? Have you ever lusted after the opposite sex in your heart? Have you ever used God's word or God's name in vain? Those are just a few of the Ten Commandments that you'll be judged by. So if you say, yes, I've done all those, then what are you? Are you innocent or are you guilty? And most of us, all of us, if we're honest, are going to say guilty. So is it heaven or is it hell? And be honest, it's hell. But the only way, there's good news, the only way that that can change is the Word of God says, if you'll confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. When Jesus went to that cross of Calvary, he went for you. He went to die that his blood would cover all the sins, past, present, and future. That his blood covered, you know, as the Lord laid it on my heart one day, that that cross that he was hung on wasn't a new cross. It wasn't nicely cut. It wasn't all varnished and smooth. It was a used cross. It was a rugged cross. It was a cross that had been used many times before. It was a cross that so many other bloods had been stained into that wood of no avail outside to appease the authorities that hung him on that cross. But when Jesus was hung on that cross, that old rugged cross, and his blood was shed, his blood covered all those stains. Those stains being the sins of the world, the iniquities of the world. That blood covered your sins, no matter what it is that you have done. And Jesus says that all sin, there's no sin any greater than the other outside of blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. And that's not, that's denying Christ. So all you need to do is realize that you are a sinner. You're no different than any of us. And that just by being a good person, as in your own mind being a good person, shoveling the neighbor's driveway or cutting the old folks' grass, that don't mean nothing. But what means something is confessing that you are a sinner and asking Jesus to save you, asking him to come into your life to forgive you of your sins as his blood covers your sins, and his word says that it's be covered, forgotten as far as the east is from the west, never to come together again, never to be remembered, never to be brought up. It's a one-shot deal that when you sin and you ask for forgiveness, it's covered. That ain't to say it's a one-shot. He'll never do it again. He'll do it each and every time you come back to him with a humbled heart. But just confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Ask him to come into your heart. You don't have to be wearing a suit, tie, fancy dress, none of that stuff. You don't have to go to big fancy buildings, stained glass windows, perfectly manicured lawnscapes, and all that kind of stuff. Right where you're at right now, just go and say, Jesus, I'm a sinner. And I pray that you would forgive me, that you would come into my heart, and that you would be my Lord. And at that time, the Lamb's Book of Eternal Life is open. Your name is written in there. Praise God. And Jesus said that when he left to ascend to the Father, he says that he goes to prepare a place for you. For in his Father's house, there are many mansions. He's preparing a mansion for you. So, my friends, and all the listeners out here, if you don't know Jesus, let that be something that you do right now. You know, we look at decisions that we make throughout our lives, whether I should go to college, whether I should get married, whether I should have children, you know, the careers that we pick. These are whether I should buy a house, a car. These are all important decisions to be made. But the most important decision to be made is the decision for Jesus Christ. You know, you might be saying, if God loves me so much, why would he send me to hell? He doesn't send you to hell. You send you to hell. He sent his son to die for you so you didn't have to go. You make that choice. Isn't that awesome? You're the one that makes the choice on where you spend your eternity. Not your parents, yes, not your wife, your husband, nobody. That's you. You get to make that decision. And I pray that tonight you would make the right decision. If you have any questions or any comments, just go to thelordsroundtable.com and click on the comment tab. And leave a comment, leave a question. You want me to pray with you, leave a prayer request, leave a way that I can get back with you, and I will be quick in doing that. So with that being said, Lord, I know I was praying to you, but I got sidetracked there. So, Father God, we just thank you for this evening, Lord. We thank you for each and everyone that's come here, Father. Father God, I pray for all the truckers that are running up and down these highways, hitting all this adverse weather conditions, yes, Lord God, that, Father God, that you would put your hedge of protection around them, Lord, and for the cars that come in contact with them, Lord. And I know I've said it before, but I love saying it, Father, that we don't change their lives by running them over, but we change their lives, and we don't do the changing, you do, but by leading them to the foot of the cross, amen. And I just praise you for that, Father. Mm-hmm. Father God, I pray for all those that are in our families. It's not if there's any, but those ones that are in our families that are lost and without Jesus. I pray that, Father, they feel mm-hmm. that drawing. Your word says that Jesus said he has all those that you have drawn unto him. And I pray, Father God, that they feel that drawing of your Holy Spirit, Lord God. When they do that one-step program, that one step, the step at the foot of the cross, Father God, where you meet them there, Lord God, and they get delivered out of the sins of darkness, united with you, Father God, that you restore them, you clean them, you stand them up, and you set them on that righteous path that you have set before them. Father God, I thank you for Ron taking out of his time to come and be with us, Lord God. I pray, Father, your hedge of protection around him and his family, Lord. Father God, I pray that you continue to open doors up to him as he has this joy in sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Your word says that we are to go out into the highways and the hedges and to share the gospel. You didn't ask us if we had something, didn't have nothing to do or if we wanted to, but you commanded us to do that, and that is what we are called to do, that great commission. And I pray forgiveness for all of us that have fallen short, and as my brother Bill calls it, the sin of silence. So, Lord God, again, I pray your blessings upon all those that are listening. And I pray, Father God, that you give us all another day to do it again. And I pray this in the blessed and the holy name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.
Amen. Amen. Love you, brother.